Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on a recently spoiled base commander from the Adventures in the Forgotten Realms Commander Precons, Vrondis Rage of the Ancients. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. The best way you can help support the channel is my Patreon. For just $1, Pages get early access to certain videos on YouTube. In fact, Pages got a chance to see this video earlier. You can also support my channel for free by simply liking, subscribing, and sharing, which also helps out a lot. You can join my Discord server for free if you want to join the Commander Tavern community. All pertinent links are down in the description. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Vrondis is a 5-4 Dragon Barbarian for 3 generic, 1 red and 1 green. He has an Enrage trigger that creates a 5-4 red and green Dragon Spirit creature token that gets sacrificed when it deals damage. This ability isn't new to Magic, but it's certainly busted in the right deck, especially since Vrondis can be your commander. Curiously, the tokens are dragons and spirits but don't fly, but that's okay because they're going to swarm the board anyways. They might get sacrificed when they deal damage, but that doesn't really matter since they're dealing 5 damage each. You might even take advantage of that and add some cards that trigger when creatures you control die. However, I'm using these tokens to enable to the dozens of combos and engines in the deck while also smashing face with them. Vrondis' second ability isn't really used in this deck since there are plenty of ways to deal him damage. That being said, if you're playing Plane Chase, then every time you roll the planar die, you'll trigger Vrondis. This is confirmed by Matt Tabak over on Twitter a couple of days ago. Now, before you begin slotting in Fractured Power Stone to your deck, keep in mind that its second ability does nothing unless you're playing Plane Chase, so you don't even get to roll the planar die. You simply tap it and it does nothing. Yes, I know this is quite the bummer, otherwise it would have been the best mana rock for Vrondis. That being said, if you do play Plane Chase, then this would be the most busted commander for that add-on variant. As I mentioned a bit earlier, Vrondis isn't the only way we can get tokens from dealing damage to creatures. Broodhatch Nantuko, Raptor Hatchling, Hornet Nest, Overgrown Armasar, Polyraptor, Saber Ants, Sprouting Phytohydra, and Sporeweb Weaver each create a creature token when they're dealt damage. The spider has the added bonus of gaining us life, which we'll see later on why it matters. The first two essentially die after the first trigger, but we do have ways of protecting our creatures, which we'll soon see as well. The important thing is that these help grow our army from their engaged triggers and help provide redundancy to Vrondis. The best of these are obviously Polyraptor and Sprouting Phytohydra since they create copies of themselves, so they create an exponential amount of creature tokens, which is one part of the many engines and combos in the deck. We'll see all of the main combos in the deck after seeing their components. Enchanting a creature with Druid's Call makes it so that creature creates a creature token just like these do. Enchant an indestructible creature with it and you're good to go. This can also be considered an engine piece like Vrondis and the previously mentioned 8 creatures. Doubling Season, Parallel Lives, and Primal Vigor are included to hasten this strategy even further. Even if it's just for Vrondis, being able to copy a 5-4 beater multiple times is no joke. Keep in mind that Primal Vigor is symmetric, so avoid playing it against an opponent with another token or +1/+1 counters matters deck. Going back to Sporeweb Weaver, Ravenous Daggertooth also gains us life when it's dealt damage. These types of triggers are important since the Enrage enablers in the deck also hit players. That way we can survive while our opponents don't, but more on that later. Blazing Sunsteel, Needletooth Raptor, Stuffy Doll, and Brash Taunter make it so our opponents survive even less than we do. If everyone's getting pinged from our Enraged enablers, but opponents are taking more damage than we are, then we'll win that war of attrition. The Raptor only hits creatures, but it can take out pretty much any creature so long as it survives what's triggering it. The Doll and Goblin are the best of these creatures since they're indestructible. The equipment is also great since it can go into any creature, preferably an indestructible one. Silver-clad Ferocidons is especially oppressive since it forces each opponent to sacrifice a permanent whenever they're dealt damage. With a toughness of 5, you can ping this 4 times each turn in order to have all of your opponents sacrifice 16 permanents each turn around the table. And that's just if we don't have any protective effects on it yet. But again, more on that later. Confidant, Ranging Raptors, and Ripjaw Raptor are the toolbox cards of the deck in terms of Enrage triggers. The first one untaps a permanent, which you can already imagine is a very important engine piece. The second one ramps us a basic land with its Enrage trigger, which is incredibly busted at accelerating the deck, especially since it's running 14 basic lands. And the last one draws us a card which is epic even when we're about to trigger it multiple times in a turn. Even then, of those, Cacophodon is the most important one at enabling us to continuously get Enrage triggers when combined with some cards we're going to see soon. However, the best tool in the deck's toolbox is Zalto Fire Giant Duke. Whenever he receives damage, you venture into the dungeon. Unlike some of the other nerfed legends with the venture mechanic, this isn't limited to once per turn. That means that if Zalto is pinged multiple times a turn, then you get to venture deeper into the dungeon multiple times per turn. Looking at the 3 dungeons available so far, Lost Mine of Phandelver is the best one if we're getting infinite venture triggers. If we go the Dark Pool route, then we'll kill off the entire table so long as we don't deck ourselves each time we complete the dungeon. That being said, Dungeon of the Mad Mage is also incredibly useful since we can draw 3 cards at the end of it and free cast one of them. Now that we saw all the Enrage triggers in the deck, how do we enable them? Well, that's the other half of most of these engines. Ashen Fire Beast, Harbinger of the Hunt, Subterranean Spirit, Pyrohemia, Chandra Flame Caller, Clash of Realities, and Sorrow's Path can all trigger Enrage by dealing damage to all of our creatures, and some of them ping us and opponents too. The first two aren't as effective since they cost more than 1 mana to activate. While they're limited to creatures without flying, none of the Enrage creatures in the deck have flying anyways, but it also means that we aren't shooting down any of our opponent's flyers. That being said, they're still okay at increasing the redundancy of Enrage enablers in the deck. Chandra, being a Planeswalker, can only activate her abilities once per turn. She does enter with 4 loyalty counters, meaning we can first have her deal 1 damage to each creature for 3 straight turns, and then we have to start upticking her once, and then downticking her once. That's not a problem since she creates 2 tokens with her first ability, which is also synergistic with the deck. Also, her Wheeling ability costs 0 loyalty to activate, so it can help us dig further through our library when we have a handful of cards we don't really need at the time. Subterranean Spirit can also be activated essentially once per turn since it taps to activate, but it combos with Cacophodon. We tap it down, it deals 1 damage to each creature without flying, triggering Cacophodon. It then untaps the spirit and we can do this all over again. This will eventually kill the dinosaur unless we do something about it, but we'll see that in just a bit. Since the spirit has protection from red, at least it doesn't kill itself. Sorrow's Path, considered by many to be one of the worst cards in all of Magic, so bad that it's a reserve list rare from the dark from way back in 1994, that's still less than $20. This is an all-star in this deck. Whenever you tap it, it deals 2 damage to you and all of your creatures. This is amazing in this deck. The only downside is that you can only tap it to swap out 2 of your opponent's blockers. That might be too situational for some. This is why the deck is also running Yevamaya Cradle of Growth and Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth. They can both make Sorrow's Path tap for mana, meaning that it's much easier to tap down to get that damage trigger. Urborg isn't really that useful here beyond that when compared to Yamevaya, but at least it can also help the 8 fetches tap down for mana as well. Sorrow's Path also triggers Cacophodon if we're able to tap it down for damage this way, and it can be untapped to use all over again. Clash of Realities is an amazing one since Vrondas is a non-spirit creature that creates spirit tokens. So long as Vrondas is indestructible, each spirit entering the battlefield will deal him damage, creating even more spirit tokens, so this is quite the engine piece as well. However, of all of these cards, the best one, save for last, is Pyrohemia. For just 1 red mana, it deals 1 damage to each creature and player. The only downside is that there has to be a creature left in play at each end step. Since we have indestructible creatures, that shouldn't be a problem. Since this also hits us, having those Enrage triggers that gain life are quite useful. Pyrohemia is definitely the best card in the deck since it only costs 1 mana to activate. It's an enchantment, it only deals 1 damage, which is enough, and most important of all, we can trigger it whenever we want as often as we can. Combined with Cacophodon, whenever it receives damage, we can simply untap a red mana source in order to tap it down again to activate Pyrohemia once more. It's a shame Vrondas wasn't also black, that way we can also include Pestilence and every other black global damage dealing permanent. All this seems fine and dandy if we ignore the fact that we have a life total and our creatures have a toughness that will afford them only so much damage before they die. However, since we want them to receive damage, we can't do anything to prevent that damage. What we want for them is to survive. Rite of Passage, the last card with the Enrage trigger in the deck, does just that. If we're pinging our creatures for just 1 damage at a time, so long as they have a toughness higher than 1, they'll not only survive each ping, but they'll get permanently stronger from it. This is definitely one of the best cards in the deck. Not only will our creatures continuously indefinitely fuel our combos, but they'll also get indefinitely larger to take out the table. Simply glorious. Besides getting bigger, we can also just make them outright indestructible with Eldrazi Monument, Soul of Nufyrexian, and Stonehoof Chieftain. Soul of Nufyrexian needs to receive 5 mana first, but that's fine if we have enough mana to really sink into our damage dealing effects. Stonehoof Chieftain gives indestructible to our attackers, but at least that lasts until end of turn. So we have to first attack with all of the creatures we want to survive in order for them to become indestructible. This is no issue, the only downside is costing 8 mana to cast. Eldrazi Monument is the best because it gives a pump and flying as well. Needing to sacrifice a creature each upkeep is no issue since our commander, as well as 9 other cards in the deck, create a creature token due to Enrage. Hammer of the Zaun, Darksteel Plate, Shield of Khadra, and Khadra Complete are equipment that make the equipped creature indestructible. While not as ideal as global indestructibility, they can at least help protect our key combo pieces or engine pieces like Cacophodon, Zalto, our commander, or any other token creating creature. These are very helpful in making those combos potentially go infinite. For instance, an indestructible Cacophodon combo with Subterranean Spirit is enough to wipe the board of all non-flyers. Nara Wolvid Familiar can also help with indestructibility, but it's only limited to making Vrondas indestructible and only during our turn. However, that's fine since Vrondas is a combo engine after all, so protecting him is as important as any other creature in the deck. Since we're also getting pinged by some global effects, gaining life is quite helpful. Verdant Sun's Avatar helps tremendously at that. This non-white Trastani helps out by gaining us life each time a creature enters the battlefield. If we're constantly pinging our commander, then we gain 4 life each time. This can go a long way in having us survive global pinging effects while ensuring our opponents don't. Speaking of massive amounts of creature tokens being created, the Vol Hellkite is just stupid good in this deck. Our commander can create a ton of Dragon Spirit tokens with the deck's many engines. If any of them connect, they get sacrificed, which again isn't so bad. But if we swing in with a dozen dragons while the Hellkite is in play, it'll create that many 6-6 dragons that do fly and won't get sacrificed when they connect. This might seem a bit win more, but it ends games in more ways than one. Alright, I hope I whet your appetite with some of the combos already mentioned, as well as some of the many engine pieces in the deck. I will now explain the more important ones with a couple of examples, since a lot of these combos and engines have redundant pieces, which is an even better thing. Let's review a couple of the ones we already saw. The Confidant is a main piece of one of the many infinitely recurring engines in the deck. Assuming it's indestructible, or when we have Rite of Passage in play, tapping down a red mana source to activate Pyrohemia will give us infinite enrage triggers. If we have more life than opponents do, this is enough to win us the game. Keep in mind that this also works with just an indestructible Cacophodon and Subterranean Spirit. This won't kill off the table, but it triggers all of our enrage triggers. The same exact concept is used with Sorrow's Path if it can tap down for mana with either Urborg or Yavimaya. This will also give us infinite green or black mana, so there's that as well. Besides these Cacophodon-based engines, any indestructible token generator can go infinite with Phyrexian Altar and Pyrohemia. When the token is created, we can just sacrifice it to the altar to get the red mana needed to fuel Pyrohemia. If we have more life than opponents do, this is enough to win us the game. However, this also works with just either Polyraptor or Sprouting Phytohydra, even if they don't have indestructible. Whenever any of these take damage, they create a copy of themselves. That copy will create further copies, etc. So even if the original receives enough damage to die, their progeny will continue on exponentially. In fact, let's do some quick math since I am a mathematician after all. Let's start simple with the Phytohydra. Without Rite of Passage or indestructibility, it takes 2 damage to die. Before that, it'll create some tokens. The amount of copies of Sprouting Hydra you will be left over with follows the Fibonacci sequence. Starting with the original, represented here by 1, one ping leaves you with 2. Another ping kills the original, but you'll have 3 left over. An additional ping kills the original copy, but you'll have 5 left over. An additional ping leaves you 8, and then 13, and then 21, etc. The Polyraptor sequence is even more disgusting because it can take 5 pings before dying. It took me a while, but it was pretty fun determining the generating formula, which is this one. The way this formula works is that after 4 pings, you'll have 16 copies of Polyraptor on the battlefield. From the 5th one on, you have 2 to the n, which is how many pings you've given so far, minus 2 to the m, which is how many pings you've given minus 5. So you have to calculate these two values and subtract them. Here's a table to give you a better idea on what you can expect after you get n amount of pings. Since the growth in both cases are unbounded, you will eventually reach infinitely many Phytohydra or Polyraptor tokens from infinitely many pings. So any of these with Pyrohemia and Phyrexian Altar is enough to go infinite via a 3-card combo. Keep in mind that Vrondris also goes infinite with Clash of Realities if he's indestructible. Since the spirits only damage Vrondris, Anara is enough to pull this off. As mentioned when I talked about the enrage triggers, even if you don't reach infinity, these engines can potentially ramp you all of your basic lands from your library with Ranging Raptors, draw you indefinitely many cards with Ripjaw Raptor, complete indefinitely many dungeons with Zalto, gain ridiculous amounts of life with Ravenous Daggertooth or Spoorwed Weaver, kill off opponents with Brosh Taunter, or a creature equipped with Blazing Sunsteel, etc. If we are creating indefinitely many creature tokens, particularly where we're not picking up opponents, we can also win via Purphoros God of the Forge and Impact Tremors. The best thing about all these engine pieces is that they can win you the game even if you're not going infinite. If you're able to maximize how often you're triggering your enrage effects, you can do a lot of damage, gain a lot of life, or get ahead with a huge advantage of the course of a full turn around the table. This deck does so many things it's crazy, so as with a lot of my other deck techs, keep that calculator handy. The following cards in the deck are the essential card advantage, responses, and mana acceleration of any deck. Collective Unconscious and Shamanic Revelation are just epic here in terms of the sheer amount of cards you can draw off of them. With so many creature tokens being created, you will draw super deep into your deck. Given how huge creatures can also get, Return of the Wild Speaker, Rishkar's Expertise, and Soul's Majesty can also draw you into the top cards. As always, bonus points for casting either Return of the Wild Speaker or Soul's Majesty off of Rishkar's Expertise. Reliquary Tower is added because it doesn't take up a slot in the deck and helps us keep our fat hand. Response-wise, I'm running Shadow Spirit, which can remove indestructibility from opponent's creatures. That way we can make sure to kill them. As a bonus, it also gives lifelink to the equipped creature. So equipping this to something like Subterranean Spirit, and we can gain a ton of life to help buffer those pinging effects. Blood Moon is included to shut down almost every non-red, triple-colored, and more deck. Not only is this such a thorn in opponent's side, but it also helps us out too. We might lose some lands because of it, but we want them to tap down for red anyways. So it also makes the fetch lands tap for red mana for Pyrohemia. Wandering Archaic helps with taxing opponents' counterspells, because if they don't, we'll just use our copy to copy their original. Not only that, but any other epic spell that isn't paid extra for, we get to copy too. The backside isn't really used in this deck, so it's almost like it isn't an MDFC. Chaos Warp, Beast Within, and Force of Vigor round out the deck's responses by being able to deal with almost anything. Interaction is super important in Commander games, and you can't go wrong with these. As for mana acceleration, we can't really run many mana dorks since they'll bite the dust. So I'm running Soul Ring, Mana Crypt, Jeweled Lotus, Arcane Signet, Gruul Signet, and Talisman of Impulse. Remember that if you're playing Plane Chase Commander, just swap out Talisman of Impulse for Fractured Power Stone and you get a free Rounders trigger. If not, it will do absolutely nothing except tap for one colorless. Obviously, Jewel Lotus and Mana Crypt aren't necessary for the deck to run, and you could just as easily swap them out for budget substitutes. Naturally, Farseek, Nature's Lore, and Three Visits are included in the deck. Being able to fetch for a double type land for just 2 mana requires no further explanation. Lastly, Reshape the Earth is also included to not only thin the deck of lands, but also to find all the utility lands in the deck like Sorrow's Path, Yamavaya, etc. It also gives you plenty of fuel for Pyrohemia and all of the other Enrage enablers that require mana to activate. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the lands. The deck's running all 8 fetch lands, Taiga, Stomping Ground, Cinder Glade, Highland Forest, Shelter Thicket, Rootbound Crag, Spire Garden, Firelit Thicket, and Command Tower, as well as the previously mentioned 7 of each basic land. As with all of my deck techs, Taiga, the more expensive fetch lands, Jeweled Lotus, and Mana Crypt aren't entirely necessary for the deck to run, and you can just as easily swap them out for any budget substitutes, and the deck will still run well enough. This brews just an idea of how to build around Rondrus, Rage of Ancients. The moment he was spoiled, I just knew I had to immediately brew around him, without even waiting to see if any other new cards would be revealed that would also work well with him. I've been waiting for a long time for an Enrage commander, so I had a lot of ideas already in my head. I would have preferred him to also be black, but I was able to manage. What I love most about these interactions in my deck is being able to win via straight up combat or combo. I always love building combo decks outside of expected colors like blue and black. This deck is a lot of fun to pilot while also making you smarter with all of the math you'll be doing with the many engines in it. Leave it to a mathematician to keep brewing mathematically complex decks, right? I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I'm the Benedict Kirby, and happy brewing.